Good morning, everyone. I'm sitting here not because I want to dissociate myself from my friends and colleagues, just we are still waiting for freshmen to join us. And, I am a person with psychosocial disability. My name is Gabor Bomos, and I have the privilege to chair this session. I am a person with psychosocial disability, and I'm quite anxious. So there is some anxiety in the panel. It is not a secret that yesterday the pairs, the storytellers and their respondents, and the project team and the advisory board members and those who were closely associated with the project had a private meeting. And I can tell you that I met two very courageous women, the storytellers, and two excellent respondents. And what we did yesterday was we tried to identify common themes, three common themes, which came out from both stories. And we will organize this session around those three questions or three themes, plus one vital message from both storytellers. Just to spend some time to relax and hope that arise. Aging can be very well tested on the concept of informed consent. Before the Second World War, this concept practically did not exist. It's a post-Second World War development. And the development internationally was not overly fast. In some countries it started earlier, in other countries much later. I am from Hungary, and in Hungary, as in other so-called socialist or communist countries, the right to informed consent was not recognized. Yet when at the age of 16 I entered neurology as a patient, not as an obligation under the law, but as a form of good practice, my neurologist asked for my consent to the treatment they were offering. And I was a minor at the time. In spite of that, they thought that it was good practice to treat me only if I agreed with what they offered to me. And then very soon, within half a year, I ended up as a psychiatric patient. And it's not my story, which is to demonstrate the things in psychiatry, but I have to tell you that it was entirely different. Still it is, although informed consent has achieved an express recognition under international human rights law in the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, in Article 25 on the right to health. But it is also one specific manifestation of legal capacity, and that is why consent to treatment is one of the major themes of the Voices Project. Very much about personal autonomy, self-determination, and legal capacity. So I really do not want to abuse my facilitator role. Let's start the session, although frankly I do not know how to deal with the plans. But let us start with the first question, which actually is that, before we start questions, the chair should introduce you the panelists. So we have Fiona, who is one of the really courageous women on this panel. one of the storytellers with a very powerful story, which the abstract of which you can read in the abstract book. And within a year time, you can read the entire story in the book. Your respondent is Bo. And another respondent is Roxanne, who is the respondent of Reshma, which is the whole program. And now, after introducing the panelists, I ask Fiona, what would be your single most important message of your story for all of us who are interested in our panel?
Probably the most important message I can give you is that what actually happened to me in the services should just not happen again to anybody else. It has been a very dehumanizing, humiliating, and embarrassing position that I was put in. I find this extremely difficult, but somewhere the system has to change. They treat people with more humanity than what they did before. Back in the 1990s, I noticed when I was first admitted to the hospital, I was very naive. I thought there was going to be some element of choice in my medication regime. I mean, the person that I am, I immediately just asked them, what is this medication? What's its properties? What's it going to do? And that. And all I got was, it's non-addictive. As I said, I was naive. I thought there was going to be a discussion and choice about this, but that didn't happen. About 2 years later, after that, and this is where the message has to be got, I was put on lithium treatment, and over the years, I experienced a lot of kidney infections. I had lithium toxicity on a number of occasions. Until I finally, in 2005, I requested my mental health files. I got some of them. They were very limited, inaccurate, misrepresented, and fabricated in places. But it was there that I discovered from my memory and also from the notes how many kidney infections I had when I was there as an inpatient and an outpatient. But most probably the 3 times before ECT sessions, they recorded that I had blood in my urine samples. And this should have automatically told them and alerted them to the fact that I had renal dysfunction associated with my lithium. But unfortunately, it was ignored. It was only years later in the file that I discovered it. Over the years, so many medics missed the opportunity to connect my kidney problems with my lithium. It was associated with my diabetes, it was associated with everything else, until finally I set about to get it removed. It was removed after 17 years of use. At the moment my kidney function is 24-25%. It's not great by any stretch of the imagination. But at least it stabilized at that root at that time. And hopefully, it would mean I can stall off dialysis if I can keep it at that level. But the message here is that the services now have a very detailed consent form, a diary to record blood serum tests and everything, and a record card in an emergency that's wrong with lithium, and the medication will not be commenced unless the consent form is fully explained to them and signed by the consultant and the patient. So my message is that hopefully my experience will not happen again, and that it can be caught earlier when it should be, and that hopefully it will reduce the incidence of it happening again.
Thank you very much, Yuma. Yesterday, when we were working on preparation for today's session, Reshma also had a very powerful message, but I am in a really tough situation now. I don't think it would be correct, and I don't think it would be okay in the spirit of the project itself if somebody else would tell Reshma's message. So still, let's all open whatever she is coming and she will be able to share an important message with all of us. So the three common themes which showed up in both stories were around questions of voluntary hospitalization and treatment versus involuntary one. Can this distinction be really made? If yes, on what grounds? And in fact, how different the treatment under voluntary and involuntary mental health treatment regimes are. Another shared issue was physical health versus mental health. Some of you who followed psychiatric communities' anti-stigma campaigns and programs may be familiar with the old slogan that mental health is just the same as physical health, schizophrenia is just, you know, like diabetes, and all these sort of slogans, which were supposed to combat stigma of mental disorder, whatever, medical understanding of what is the disability field for psychosocial disability. But how is it in the lived experience of people who experience both physical health issues and mental health issues? The third area, which was shared by both storytellers, was about the gender dimension of what happened to them, them consenting or not consenting to the treatment. So let's go one by one. So Fiona, I'm asking you to share your personal experience about what is the difference, what was the difference in your case between voluntary and involuntary treatment?
The first time I knew something was a mystery to have my rational thoughts in that. So I eventually was brought to be admitted to the local unit. time during the admission interview. For all intents and purposes, it was a legal capacity assessment with the questions that they were asking. They come across as the most ludicrous questions that you could ask a person, beginning with, how much is the Irish independent? It moved on to then count back from 107s. The next thing was recall this name and address. And I was asked for it 10 minutes later. And the fourth question, is anyone putting thoughts into your head? And my response to that question is what actually stirred me up. As I said, I thought this was voluntary, but for all intents and purposes of legal capacity assessment, and on top of it, it was subtle coercion. Subtle coercion that if I dissented or did not cooperate at the time, then hovering over my head was involuntary detainment. By the time I got to that fourth question, I was so distressed that all I wanted was to get out of the room, and I would have said anything to do that. What happened next was something I hadn't expected and shocked me, leaving me humiliated, embarrassed, and dehumanized. All of my clothes were actually removed and locked away several days. And this was a voluntary person. Obviously the assumption was you weren't really there of your own free will, because we think you're going to respond. In 2011 we move on, when two reasons I needed treatment and I had an ulterior motive as well, that I got myself involuntarily detained. I was very sick by that stage after 2 years. And in the hospital, because it's more men that are involuntarily detained than women, I ended up being given men's pajamas to wear, and my socks and shoes were even taken away from me. I pleaded with a psychiatrist after 3 days, just give me my socks and my shoes, let nothing go through my foot with my diabetes, then it causes a problem. He was a particularly humane psychiatrist that I'd met over a number of times, and he got my shoes and socks for me. Involuntary detainment is probably one of the most humiliating things that could happen to you. But as I said, I had an ulterior motive, and that was I wanted a mental health tribunal. I wanted to have my say. I wanted to outline what had happened to me in the services before. So I went through the tribunals. There was a solicitor who was appointed to represent me, who I met about 24 hours before the tribunal, or just before it. And I just said to her, I said, I'm sorry, you don't know the story. You only know what's in this current file. If you don't mind, you just sit beside me and I'll do the rest. I was very agitated and very sick. But I knew what I was doing and I knew what I was saying. I remember after the hearing was finished, I literally, when I got the report, went out to the garden of the unit and set fire to it. I can't remember what it says now. I'm trying to get a copy of it just to see. Because 3 months later I hadn't seen it in the hospital anymore. And this time I kept the report. And I wasn't looking for my detainment to be overturned. I didn't want just to be listened to. I wanted to be actively heard. So in the end, really, there's not much difference between voluntary and involuntary. Because when you want to leave as a voluntary patient, you've made involuntary. So I just said to them, okay, bring it on. Make me involuntary again. Give me another chance at a mental health tribunal and another chance to have a go at trying to correct not just what happened to me, but what happens to a lot of people in the services. That's all I can say about that.
Thank you so much, Yola. Now I'm asking Bo, who is Fiona's respondent, to share your views about this question of voluntary treatment or involuntary treatment. How do you see what happened in Fiona's story?
Thank you, Before I have any comments on this, I have introduced myself a little bit to explain why I'm acting as a family response. Because both of us are attending the master program of disability loan policy in the center. So we know each other in the class. So we basically share the common knowledge about Irish ecosystem, which I don't know much about. But luckily, I have learned Fiona's trust about, you know, at least I can be a good listener for the whole process. So Fiona mentioned that Irish law in the current Irish legal Mental Health Act 2001, that even a voluntary patient can be stopped to leave or changed to involuntary if the, you know, based on the psychiatric assessment. Fiona already mentioned that. Which means that even though we are a voluntary patient, the psychiatrist or the hospital, the medical professionals, they still have the total power to control your life, whether you can leave or not. That's not to say, you know, that there's a lot of the, obviously, that tactical tricks, like they make you realize that you are under control of somebody else. For example, you know, the taking clothes away, or, you know, forcing isolation, and they show off the power from time to time to remind you of that. And behind this is that the legal power that's if this is fit, it can change you into involuntary. That's the, you know, as I mentioned in the picture part, like, this law can disable itself because it creates such a power imbalance. And within this context, I don't think there exists any room for real and general meaningful consent or, you know, any meaningful choice. But there's something that's not mentioned in our draft or by Fiona. It's like, I think Fiona's story, how to say, reflects the appeal that's raised by an Australian scholar that the Western system, I can say that the Western system, is of putting too much emphasis about involuntary standards. So which you have to create like a two-track system, like voluntary and voluntary, which means that the limited resources are put into the involuntary system. And in Fiona's case, the first admission, she sought for help as a voluntary patient, but has to examine about the legal capacity, or in other words, the lucidity. But when she, again, when she really needs the medical help or assistance, she had to, I don't know how to say that, behave and qualified herself to be involuntary detained. It made no sense to me, at least. How, you know, why there's barriers in between of you and help, even though, you know, you are seeking it voluntarily. There's a debate whether, you know, the forced treatment should be used as a last resort. There's a debate, maybe, this debate may last further, but it makes no sense, like, they set such a legal barrier to voluntary and people who are really seeking help. I think maybe we can imagine, you know, the redesigned system, like, let's take one, not two, and non-coercive, and a service system really respect people's choice, especially who ask for help by themselves.
Thank you very much.